Our next presenter is from Sunlife Insurance. He's witnessed financial struggles for years, which helped him realize how many people need a strong financial plan. This sparked him to start with Sunlife Financial, first working with families, but then he also moved into corporate clients as well, as he realized that they need to strategize to find the potential for benefits that are eligible to business owners. And so this really sparked a passion for him. So now he's specializing in corporate and estate planning strategies to benefit business owners, and he's here to talk to you about insurance, taxes, and leveraging for real estate, otherwise known as cha-ching. Ladies and gentlemen, Dan Brophy.
Hey guys, first want to thank Mogul and James for having me. Just let me know if the volume's all right, and I see that we're behind, so I'm going to jump into my slide here right away and get going with a bit of content, but I will try to keep it not too boring. Good. All right. All right. So tax sheltering for cash liquidity for the savvy real estate investor. I don't know what comes to mind when you hear those words in a statement, tax sheltering, you know, cash liquidity. I don't know, not paying taxes, access to your money. You know, what about the word insurance? You know, what thoughts come to mind? You know, extra costs, you know, what about the emotions? You know, my car insurance went up, you know, it seems like an extra cost, but what I want to do, you know, by the end of this is kind of roll that around, and instead of it being a need, show it more as a want, right? Because, you know, we look at RSPs, TFSAs, different like words when it comes to tax, so tax-free, a TFSA. We all are investment growth off of the TFSA is tax-free or tax deductible, you know, if we're replacing a water heater on our rental homes. Tax deferral, an RRSP. But what about tax sheltering? And there's only one of the only ways of doing that is using a permanent life insurance plan. So what else? Okay, with permanent insurance, you know, we need to start looking at as an asset class. But at the same time, we also need to make sure that we are doing making the right solutions for the client. So there still needs to be a need, which means there's many different like scenarios that come into play. You know, we could have like a couple that is on their second home, maybe their second rental property home, or a doctor that has a professional corp that's bringing in, you know, active business income. But he might have a holding corp on the side that, you know, he might be investing in real estate with as well. So there's a lot of different ways we can go about it. But for this presentation, I'm just going to try to keep it on personal taxes. I will do one slide involved with like the benefits of holding corps and running your real estate through it. But yeah, all in all, what we're going to do here tonight is we'll do a review on taxes. Strategy comparison on why we want to do this. I won't dive too deep into products, but I'll introduce two of the products that we use. We'll do a case study to see some numbers. I'm a numbers guy, but you know, I don't want to make it any more confusing than it already is. And then how we can access these cash values. And that's about it. Once again, like James said, I'm not an accountant. I'm very knowledgeable on the taxation of insurance. But we always want to talk to our trusted and liked accountant. I work with a lot of accountants that strictly deal with insurance industry at Sun Life. So I'm always relying on them to make sure that we're making the best solutions for the clients. So taxes, what can I say? There's two certain things in life. That's death and that's taxes, right? So we have personal taxes, which are based on marginal tax rates. We have active business income. So that would be actual business income. Like if you're an electrician, you know what you're charging for your services. We get taxed on our eligible and non-eligible dividends with our corporations. And then we have passive income and capital gains. And you know, James wanted me to kind of build this around real estate investments, but you guys deal with a lot of passive income and a lot of capital gains. So yeah, passive income, like the definition for that is income that requires little to no effort to earn and maintain. Now, I don't know about you guys. I used to have a rental property and I don't think there's anything where there's no effort involved. whether that's physical or mental. You know, you could have a poor tenant, you know, a hot water tank goes, what else happens, you know, rentals, you know, if you're into building and flipping, that all comes into play. And then in regards to capital gains tax, you know, if we make $100,000 profit off of the sale of your rental home, 50% of that $100,000 is going to be added as income and then taxed. So that's kind of the solution we're looking to achieve here is in regards to capital gains and passive income. So what we do on one of the things is an asset transfer strategy. So we compare the value of your life insurance against the taxable investment. So in regards, you know, it could be a non-registered stock that you're invested in, but, you know, real estate as well, it's taxable investment. So by transitioning a portion of your taxable assets into insurance policy, we can increase the estate value substantially while tax sheltering your money. It provides exposure to different ranges of assets. It's tax exempt growth within the policy. And we also have access to these cash values, which provide liquidity for future funding of property or to subsidize a healthy retirement. So this slide here, this breaks it down. So this over here would be a traditional investment. So that we're gonna take a look at this as a rental or property. And then, you know, if we ever have to liquidate that investment, we have tax on deferred gains, whether it's death or when we sell it during our lifetime. So with our proposed strategy, you know, we're gonna transfer some of that tax investment into a whole life or a universal life insurance policy. So there's no tax on the growth of these policies. It's always tax-free on death any time of your life. You do have access to cash values through either a policy withdrawal, a policy loan, or a collateral loan. We'll get into that a little deeper further down the slides. But what happens on death? What happens to your estate? So we'd liquidate investments. There's always taxes on deferred gains for any taxable investment. But when it comes to insurance, it's always paid tax-free. So what ends up happening is that your estate, it multiplies your estate. Essentially, you're paying less taxes. The estate's paying less taxes, and you get more money to whether it's people you're passing it on to and so on. So these are permanent insurance solutions. These are two of the products that we use. One's called a universal life insurance policy. And one's what Sun Life we call it as a participating policy, which other people might know it as a whole life policy. They're both permanent plans that can provide an increasing death benefit and cash value. You can overfund these policies in order to increase your tax-free growth on it. You can stop paying after you build enough cash value within the policy. You can stop paying the policy, always creditor protected. So that, you know, things change, things go sideways, deals blow up. Your cash values and insurance policy are creditor protected if a beneficiary is designated. If we have it going to the state, there's still situations where they can come after it. But that's why we always want to have a beneficiary designation. With a participating life insurance policy, same kind of thing. The only thing, the difference in here, which I highlighted, it's very, with the universal life, it's more flexible in cost. It also puts you in the driver's seat. So you're in charge of how much funding you're going to put into the policy. You can also customize the assets as well. So it's based off of various mutual funds. So you can invest it into like a US growth equity, global funds, tech funds. Whereas with the participating policy, it's built into what's called the Sun Life Diversified Account. And that's built of mainly private fixed income, real estate, mortgages, equities, government and corporate bonds. So this is a very strong structured policy, very little risk involved. It's been managed by Sun Life for many years, and it takes the steering wheel away from you guys, which kind of forces a fixed base premium, which doesn't allow the policy to go sideways. Because, you know, if you underfund these ULs, so if we don't fund them appropriately, sometimes later down the road, when the insurance cost is higher, as we age, it gets more expensive. These policies can actually collapse if they're not properly managed. But I help people do that and show them how it's done. All right. So we don't need to read through this whole thing. The reason why I brought this up is, you know, just like a tax-free savings account, there's limits on it. Like as of 2021, we can now put in $75,500. Same with RSP contribution room. So they call this the 250% rule. It's another name for it is an anti-dump rule. And the reason is it's discouraging people to use these policies as, you know, an investment. And the way I have to put it as well is I work in a very compliance-driven industry. So I have to do a needs analysis. I can't just go and present this product to someone where there's a $250,000 death benefit. Sure, they're going to have a huge cash value in the end. But if they have a debt ratio where they need to have $1.5 million of insurance, and I don't sell them that term insurance and go ahead and sell them this as a tax shelter, as an asset, I'm not doing my job as a financial advisor. But let's call a spade a spade. It is a tax shelter. It's one of the only tax shelters, and I do accept it as an asset class for what it can do. Moving on to that. Yeah, so for this case study, you know, I don't want to get it too confusing. The way I decided to do this, it's going to be the same couple at three different points in their life, at age 30, age 40, and age 50. It's a joint last to die policy. So that means it's a joint policy where the premiums keep getting paid. This is an estate plan to make sure that the money is going into the state for future generations for wealth transfer. So it's a joint last to die. So that means the policy doesn't pay out until the second person passes away. We can reverse that and do a joint first to die if we want to have money for the surviving spouse. I used a SunPAR accumulator. And what the SunPAR accumulator does, it's our kind of our most aggressive approach into getting early cash values. But what I did, I kept the premium the same. So what that means is with the 30-year-old, we have a higher face value because it's more affordable at a younger age. And I lowered that as we went down through the age in order to keep the cost and premium. And the reason I did that is I'll show on the graphs on the next slide. We also put maximum premium. So like I said, we're only allowed to put so much money into these policies to keep them on side with the CRA, but that's all done through our actuaries. It's already built into the policy. They only allow you to add so much. So I put the maximum premium on that, and we'll take a look what comes of. Okay, so after 10 years into the policy, this is the 30-year-old couple down here. We've sheltered about roughly $125,000, $126,000. We have now grown our tax-free cash value of $151,000. Our death benefit has gone from the original face value of $400 up to $900. So we've almost doubled our death benefit. The 40-year-old, $127,000, around the same cost, same cash value, but as you see, our death benefit is less. And that's because as we age, the pure cost of insurance goes up, where you have more time when you're 30 years old for that death benefit to grow. So your estate value grows substantially the younger you start these, is what I'm trying to get at. And yeah, the 50-year-old, starting at 50, this is after 10 years, around the same cost. This is our tax-free growth, and the death benefit is just over $500,000. After 20 years into the policy, we've now sheltered around $250,000 here. Cash value, $398,000. Our death benefit is now 1.5. Now, I just want to make a note. This is not to confuse it. I'm just maxing it out, and we're just overfunding these policies just to see what they'll do. After 10 years, after maxing, you can actually defer the cost of the insurance, and you don't have to pay for it again for life. It will continue to grow. The cash values will pay for the policy, you know, because things change, right? You know, you could be doing well 10 years and maybe 20 years, you're starting to wind down. So you want to stop paying for this policy. That is an option. And then finally, we did a 30-year, which would bring our 50-year-olds to around 80 years old if they paid into it. So we've now put an estate value up to $2.1 million. $807,000 tax-free growth, and we've sheltered the original $378,000. Let's back up on here. hope I'm not losing you guys. Sometimes it's tough explaining this, so I try to keep it as fun as possible. So this represents our 30-year-olds, and with a death, if they were to pass away at about 85 years old. So this pretty much is a typical investment, putting back the same return. So I use, right, like I use the whole life policy. Right now, Sun Life kicks back 6% out of their dividends. So that's the return you're getting reinvested into the cash values. So this shows in a typical taxed investment, and we compare it. So on death at 85, with this insurance policy at $400,000 face value, putting in the same amount of money as you would into a typical investment. After we liquidate those investments, we got tax on those deferred gains. So the state ends up getting $724,000 out of that, whereas in a tax-free death benefit, the state is getting $4 million at age 85. That's a strategy advantage of about $3.3 million. And that's, like I said, maxing out, continuing to pay all your life. We don't need to do that. But everyone's plan, you know, is tailored to their needs. We'll skip these because I didn't put those in order. Okay, so we want to access our cash values. This is the three different ways we can actually access cash values. Now, I'm still basing this off of personally owned insurance. The same thing works for corporately owned insurance. There's just a little more tax benefits, which I'll try to get into. I don't want to bog people down with the differences because we have the same, it's the same kind of outcome here. We're looking to tax shelter money, get some tax-free growth, and maximize our state, right? So one of the ways is cash withdrawals. I don't really use these much. So this is taking direct money out of your policy account. The only problem is with this is that it takes money out of the cash values, which also helps fund the policy. So sometimes, like I said, it can upset the cash to death benefit ratio, in which all of a sudden you might owe more money just to keep the policy going. We can also take a policy loan, so be our own bank. Sun Life will loan the money out of the cash value. This is a more popular one because it doesn't affect the cash value or the death benefit growth. It does charge an interest rate back to you, whether you want to pay that off or now, or pay it off right away, start putting monthly payments on it, or pay it off in 20 years. Some people don't pay it off at all. It just comes off of the death benefit and the cash value at the time the policy pays out. The most tax efficient way, but complex way, is a collateral assignment. So that is where we assign the policy to a third party lender, such as a bank. There's only a few people that will actually put one of these leveraged plans in place. There's lots of loan criteria, but yeah, the third party lender, the bank, becomes the owner and the beneficiary of your policy. They will give you a loan based off of the cash value of that policy. Typically, the last time I heard it's about 90% for a participating, so whole life policy, because they're more structured, they're more stable. They will do it with ULs, but sometimes they go off of a much smaller, like 75%. The good thing about this is, though, the loan that they give you, it doesn't go towards income, and it is a tax deductible business expense if you do have a corp. Very in-depth planning involved, as interest rate changes can really affect the outcome of these policies. You know, if we see a massive interest rate hike and you owe more on it, more on the loan to pay this policy off, you know, that's what happens. But a lot of professionals will use this to fund retirement. And a lot of the times they don't pay it back because it doesn't matter if when they pass away, that remainder of the loan is paid by the death benefit, and whatever's left over of the remainder of the death benefit will then go to the beneficiary that was named. So definitely a great strategy to use, but like I said, we need to do a lot of planning involved. Sun Life is pivoted towards helping clients in this area. We have salary-based lawyers and accountants that work out of head office. And why I say salary-based, they're not really, there's no reason there's for them to sell you anything more than they need to. There's no contractual agreements, but the best thing about this is they take a look at your entire book and make sure that we have proper future projections of growth, your tax liability in the end, and then they're going to tailor a plan for you in order to meet the needs, right? So yeah, I'll just touch a little bit on the corporately owned. So yeah, I understand some people do hold all their insurance, whether it's rental properties or house flips, through corporations, well, such as a holding corporation. So the same kind of thing, the corporation now owns the policy, is now the beneficiary. So the death benefit gets paid tax-free to the corporation if anything were to happen. The best thing about owning your policy corporately is, you know, we're paying it with corporately tax dollars, but it also provides a capital dividend account credit. So what that means, I don't know if you guys know much about a capital dividend account, but dividends are taxed lower. Some people pay themselves through T4 income. Some people pay themselves through dividend. What this does, it puts a credit on top of your capital dividend account so that we can get money out of the corporation more tax efficiently. And that especially if there was a death involved, right? And I don't want to get too deep involved with this, but like I said, guys, if you want to reach out to me, I can go through this. I have a lot of information that I can provide digitally. But yeah, I don't know how are we doing for time, James? I just want to leave it at this. I don't know if I'll make any enemies or not, but I'm a big hockey fan, right? So Oilers to be exact. When I take a look at something like this, you know, offense will win games. Connor McDavid's will win games. You know, it takes a strong defense in order to actually win championships and cups. So this is what I look at as, you know, using a participating a policy or a universal life. It's an offensive defenseman. You know, it's there when you need it, but it also can put the puck in the back of the net as well. So yeah, that is it, guys. I'll stop the share. Hopefully we saved a bit of time.
Great. Thank you, Dan Brophy. Oh, I'm still muted. Here we go. Great. Thank you, Dan Brophy, for that information. That is fantastic. Dan Brophy is from Sun Life Financial. We really appreciate you coming out tonight. Now, we are going to take a networking working break. And so we are going to take 10 minutes. Jen is going to put us into the breakout room, so we'll get a chance to do that. And then we'll have the last presentation of the night, where we get to welcome back James Canull again for the secrets that accountants can't tell you. So that sounds very good. You guys don't want to miss that. Make sure you stick around and have fun networking. We'll see you in 10 minutes.